Hey everyone, Corey from Aquarium Co-op. Today we're talking pufferfish, one of my absolute favorite. It's probably one of the bigger topics that I feel like there's tons of misinformation on, lots of opinions based on what they've kept, and then projections based on I've kept this fish, so therefore that fish will do that. And that's essentially what I'm going to be doing too, is giving you my advice on what I have kept in a store and personally, and what I think are good guidelines. And, you know, that's kind of how we get started in this topic, if you will. And I think the important part is everything I say, take it with a grain of salt, because every puffer fish is different. I don't care if it's a pea puffer, a mabu puffer, a faaka puffer. Just because one person can do it doesn't mean that the next puffer is going to act the same way. Every puffer that I've kept as a pet, even of the same species, has been very different personality-wise, what they want to eat-wise, that type of thing. So think of it in your mind like a dog. Just because your neighbor has a dog or your family has a dog and you buy the same breed doesn't mean that your dog, it can be totally scared of everything and then their dog is super aggressive and then the same species of dog down the road acts completely different. So that's, you know, what you got to kind of think of. And they all eat different foods. This one loves canned food. That one loves, you know, whatever it loves, that type of thing. So realize that they're all going to be different. They're individual animals. And so know that going forward, that all the advice I give, it could be totally true or not true to your specific puffer that you want to keep. I can only give guidelines based on what either I have kept or I've watched my customers keep and what they have and haven't had success with. So the first thing I think I should address, there are a lot of puffer fish. There's freshwater puffers, there's brackish water puffers, and there's saltwater puffers. Today, I'm mostly gonna focus on freshwater puffers and maybe a little bit on brackish and not so much on salt because I don't have a ton of experience with, let's say, like porcupine puffers, the mappa puffer, that type of thing. So I'll leave that to someone who has much more experience than I do with that. But yes, one of the big questions is there are a ton of freshwater puffers. To name a few, like I did earlier, the pea puffer also goes by the dwarf Indian puffer, or dwarf puffer goes by, bumblebee puffer. So then you've got things like Amazon puffers, avocado puffers, red-eyed puffers, arrowhead puffer, hairy puffer, faaka puffer, mabu puffer, Congo puffer, both the Murius red version and the Sholdentai Congo spotted puffer. It's kind of newer back into the hobby just since last year. I'm sure I probably just missed about five more species that can be gotten in the trade relatively easy, but those are the ones I can think of off the top of my head that are true freshwater and you could probably track down within a year or so. Another common one people ask me about is the Nile puffer, which is also a faaka puffer. And then there's some of the brackish water species. The most common they're gonna get sold as freshwater would be figure eight puffers and then the green spotted puffer or the GSP. And they're varying levels of salinity and stuff like that. They can live for a while in freshwater, but really in their full life cycle should transition to some amount of salt at some point. So the other things I want to get out of the way before I start tackling individual questions you guys have about puffers would be how they eat. So typically most puffers have teeth, also kind of known as like beaks. They'll call them as like a beak, and basically it's two big, well, it's actually four teeth, but they form like a beak-like mouth. And a lot of times if you can really see that beak, the teeth are too long, and if they keep growing, they can actually get to a point where its mouth is open but it can't open or close because the teeth have grown the mouth apart. So what we do is we want to feed most of them crunchy food, so that might be things like snails, clams on the half shell, mussels. It could be krill, freeze-dried krill for some species works great. Some puffers will self-trim their teeth. In fact, they'll go rasp on rocks. In worst-case scenarios, you actually have to do puffer dentistry, and you'll have to trim their beaks down or their teeth down, which that's what we're trying to avoid. So kind of how often does a puffer need to eat that kind of stuff? I would say more often the better. I would say probably not less than 3 times a week. And they're, depending on the puffer, different puffers have different speeds of growth on their teeth. So for instance, like a pea puffer, we don't really have to worry about the issue at all. Their teeth don't grow fast enough, and they can live off things like frozen bloodworms and that type of thing. Whereas other puffers, like let's say an Amazon puffer, they have that problem where their teeth grow pretty quick. And so feeding them crunchy food is very important. What else do I want to touch on that? So when it comes to puffers, almost all puffers want to eat frozen or live foods. You can get them on to dry foods, but it is difficult. So go into it thinking it'll only eat frozen probably. And then it's a good thing when you can get it on to dry food. And if you have a puffer that will only eat frozen, it's a good idea to start investing in some things like VitaChem, which is a vitamin soak. You can soak clams, you can soak shrimp, that type of thing, in vitamins and help get them vitamins that way. So the last thing I think about puffers that, you know, gets this conversation started and lays the foundation to everything we're going to talk about is their wicked good eyesight. So they have eyesight, and the number that's thrown around, which I haven't like tested it, but they can see 30, 40 feet outside of an aquarium. So they can really see it when you walk into the room and that type of stuff. And that's what gives them what we perceive to be all of that intelligence. We see them and they see us from across the room and they go, hey, look, Corey's coming or whoever's coming. And we're the one that feed them and stuff like that. So we translate them being super interactive with us as intelligence. I'm not saying they're not an intelligent fish, but they don't have crazy high intelligence comparatively to other fish. They just have way better vision. And, you know, it's almost the same, really. Better vision makes for a lot. So that kind of leads into the next thing, and that would be environment enrichment. Because they do have such good vision, they're very inquisitive, their eyes can move independently, and it's usually best to have an environment that, let's say, has lots of live plants, if that species will allow it, or lots of nooks and crannies for it to go around in. They love to hunt live things like snails, shrimp, maybe even crayfish, that type of stuff. One little tidbit, if you're going to feed crayfish or crabs, sometimes it's best, so they have pinchers, right? It's best to cut off the pinchers so it can't grab the puffer in the eye. Even though they're designed to do that, in the wild, if it was to get hit in the eye and it loses an eye, that just happens. But if it's your pet of 12 years, you're going to feel really bad when it loses an eye because we didn't, cut one of the claws. So, you know that there's at least a risk there. I myself don't cut the claws because I'm kind of a baby and I just can't do it. Like, I just don't enjoy doing that. So I don't feed, big clawed things very often. And the worst is about fiddler crabs for my puffers. And they're relatively weak to the size of puffer I'm feeding. So, but if I was feeding very small puffers, I would not be using something with big pinchers that could do some serious damage. The next segue, I suppose, is someone, Joel mentioned, I do have Murphy Cam, which that's a live camera on my Mabu puffer at the store. It runs 24 hours a day. Obviously, at night, they are, it's kind of dim, so you're not going to see a whole lot. But during the day, you can see quite a bit. You can see us eating, or not us, but you can see it eating. Let's start diving into some questions, because I think that will start taking the conversation in different directions. And I think I've covered a lot of the basics fairly quickly, and we'll go from there. So let me dive in. The chat's been just going a million miles an hour. What's a good live food for puffers? The best one probably that I can think of, there's two, and that is something like a ram's horn snail or Malaysian trumpet snail. So the Malaysian trumpet snails, they get a bad rap online saying they break puffers' teeth. I mean, at this point, I probably fed, 1,000 puffers or more, like in my possession between a store and my home. And they've eaten Malaysian trumpet snails, and I personally have never witnessed chipped teeth or anything bad from it. I'm not going to say it couldn't happen, but a lot of times on the internet and just things in general, when we have a bad experience, we want to tell everyone so they don't have that same bad experience. And it can spread like wildfire. And sometimes, if I get in a car accident and I tell you cars kill people, and that spreads and no one ever uses a car again, that could happen. Just like mystery or Malaysian trumpet snail chipped my puffer's tooth and it's horrible. Don't ever do it. I personally haven't run into that problem. So snails, Malaysian trumpet snail, ram's horn snails, both breed pretty quick, grow pretty quick, which that makes it a good one to feed to puffers. And then the other one is the self-cloning crayfish. You can get them going pretty quick, and you can get them at the right size, so they don't really get big pinchers or anything like that. I find them to be a good food source. Unfortunately, those are illegal in my state, so I can't use those to my advantage. In fact, all crayfish are illegal. So, but that's a good question, and that's a good live food source. Obviously, you wouldn't want a crayfish this big being fed to a pea puffer that only gets about that big. That's not going to make a whole lot of sense. If puffers aren't that smart, which fish is most intelligent? I don't know which fish is going to be most intelligent. Typically, the bigger the brain is, so bigger fish typically have bigger brains, the more intelligence it has. You know, like the Mabu puffer, for instance, gets somewhere maybe between 27 and 36 inches in the wild slash in captivity. So naturally, its brain is going to be bigger than a pea puffer. But I don't know, you know, exactly what fish is going to be the smartest. I haven't been able to issue those tests and grade them yet. I'm still grading, so. Let's see. Good tank setup for a figure eight puffer. So, being that they're brackish water, you want to get some salinity in there. And when we talk about salinity, I feel a lot of people miss the fact that we really want the minerals from the salt. So we want to use a marine salt, not just like an aquarium salt, which those are very different. We want all the minerals. That's really what the puffer wants for its internal organs. It needs that mineral content. So if you had crazy hard water, you could maybe get by with normal aquarium salt, but it's really just easier to use like ocean, instant ocean or something like that, reef salt. But for figure eight puffer, you know, maybe you could shoehorn it in a 29 gallon. I would say more like a 40 breeder or a 55. They can get relatively big, 4 to 6 inches. You almost never see them. You see them like this big in a store. They're usually underweight. They're usually all beat up. Their fins are super worn down because they're living with a bunch of other puffers in too small of a tank space. Sometimes I've seen them with African cichlids being sold at stores, but at the same time, some stores also sell African cichlids as brackish water, right? You got to put salt in with them. And I don't recommend figure eight puffers with African cichlids. Figure eight puffers, for the most part, are one of a fairly aggressive puffer. And sometimes they don't even, you know, tolerate their own kind. But you would want lots of cover, lots of things to explore, caves, that type of stuff. Figure eight puffers, assuming you could get it to grow in the level of brackish water you're going to provide, would love plants. But that's the kind of setup I would set up. I would do relatively low light, not super high light, you know, but lower light makes them be a little more active in my experience. So let's talk about, are freshwater puffers ever aggressive towards the arm in the tank? Do you think if you put your hand in Murphy's or Hank tank, you would bite me? So my Mabu puffers that I've owned have never made an attempt to bite me ever. That being said, with Fa'aka puffers and stuff, we definitely have had employees almost get bit. And yeah, I think it's one of those things that there are some that are really aggressive. Like, what was the other one? We had a hairy puffer that it was just bonkers aggressive. And so we had to kind of like get him trapped against a side of the tank with a net and kind of clean the algae and stuff like that. And he would kill any algae that we tried. So he was a solo only fish. In fact, he would actually even, you know, bite up plants because he was kind of just like a rabid dog, just chewing on everything, whether it was your arm or, you know, whatever. Which leads me to a good point. Whenever you transfer a puffer, it's best to use it in a container. So like one of those specimen containers, or if you have a cup or a pitcher, something, you can use a net to guide it in there. But if a puffer expands up out of water and it takes in a bunch of air, sometimes it can't expel it all. And if you can't get that air back out of the puffer, it throws off its swim bladder and it usually leads to death. So it's best to always move them with underwater. Now, pea puffers and stuff, I've only actually ever seen one puff up like once ever, and I've handled hundreds, if not thousands, of pea puffers. So they're a really low risk one. Whereas like Mabou puffers and Faka puffers, if you were to lift them out with a net, like every time ever, they pretty much will expand. And, you know, a lot of times people ask me, I saw my puffer, you know, expand. Is that bad? It could be. So it's a defense mechanism. The goal would be that, like, let's say, like, there's a classic video on YouTube. If you go look it up, I think it's like Wonders of Lake Tanganyika or something. And it's a Mabou puffer and it's swimming along in like an otter or seal or something like that. I don't know. River otter, I guess. It would be a river otter. River otter like grabs this thing and it expands to like the size of a basketball. And what it does is it forces the jaws of the river otter open. And then it just floats there like a basketball. Otter swims away. It deflates. Yeah, it's got some wounds, but it's not dead. And so it's a defense mechanism. And they can, you know, just do it. If they do it like really quick, so if they're exercising their muscles just to make sure that defense mechanism works or stretching, that type of thing, it'll kind of just go like this and then right back down. So it's just, you know, it's like you're stretching and that's them doing that. And I want to say I see it 2 or 3 times a year. When it used to be that I had my computer and my Mabou puffer like right next to me, I saw it more often. But it's not a common thing for them just to stretch like that. But if they were to experience some kind of trauma, like being harassed by, you know, someone pounding on the glass or a fish was attacking them, a lot of times they'll stay inflated for maybe 10 minutes, something like that. And that I do think is bad because that means they've witnessed trauma or a lot of stress or something like that. So in general, you don't want to see your puffers puff. But realize they have to do it every once in a while. Well, they don't have to, but they choose to do it just to stretch and make sure it works and stuff like that. So, yeah, it's leading me to more things to talk about. So a lot of the puffers are predatory, and so they want to hunt. And things like Faka puffers, Mabou puffers, some of the larger puffers, they do well in a sand substrate because they want to burrow into it. But also they want to blow. They actually have this, like, they kind of squirt water at the sand, and the goal is that it moves the sand and leaves the crustacean. So sand being light, it wisps away and leaves just a snail or something like that so they can grab it. So that's a lot of times why you'll see sand with puffers. I've got a coarse sand, which is the Aquarium Co-op Super Sand, and it works great for Mabou puffers that I've seen. You know, so, and a lot of my employees, they have Faka puffers and they use it for that as well. So, just a little sidebar there. I don't want to forget it by the end. So, do you use market clams or do I stick to Hikari half shell clams? Trying to find more variety, and Hikari is a bit expensive. So my advice, if you're going through a lot of clams, is get the Ocean Nutrition clams on the half shell, and they'll sell them in up to 2 pound bags. That's the cheapest I've found. And for me, it's cheaper to buy it that way than it is to go to the supermarket, because at the market, you're paying for a clam, you're paying for both sides, and then you have to crack it open a lot of times, because unless your puffer is big enough, the only clams that really work well are like the Manila clams. All the other ones are like crazy hard to crack through. So I find it best to use the Ocean Nutrition. If you've got like smaller puffers, like let's say a hairy puffer or something like that, typically Hikari is okay, but when you start using massive amounts of clams, you want to be buying them in bulk, and 2 pounds at a time is the largest on the half shell I've found personally. You can also buy things like mussels on the half shell and stuff like that from sometimes like Asian markets and stuff. There's a little tip, don't bother buying Japanese trapdoor snails that are frozen. It's literally hard to break that shell with a hammer. I thought I'd found it. Like, great, I can buy frozen snails. It'd be perfect. Hitting them with a hammer and the hammer's bouncing off. No wonder when my puffer was this big, he would bite it and it would shoot out like, you know, like a bullet, because it just, he'd put all the pressure on it and it could not crack that shell. And sure enough, it was hard to do with a hammer. So I could see why he was struggling with it. Let's see. Do I have dwarf puffers? Only at the store. I don't keep them personally, but we always have like a ton of them in the store because they're very popular because we have so many puffers in the store. Everyone wants to own a puffer, and for most people, a pea puffer makes the most sense probably. good tank mates for Amazon puffers, I would say things that aren't aggressive. So lots of Tetras, Rasboras. You know, I might shy away of something like a rainbow fish just because when it comes time to eat, they're going to dominate the food. And that's really what it comes down to when you're mixing puffers and fish. Assuming the puffer's not going to kill the fish, you're left with, well, I need to feed this puffer specific things. And so, like, let's say you put clams in for that puffer. If you have clown loaches, they love clams just as much. So now they're fighting for the food, and usually a clown loach is more boisterous and outgoing and will attack that food more than the puffer will. So you want to look for tank mates that, one, won't really interact with the puffer much, and two, don't really want to eat the same food. So, you know, like maybe hatchet fish would be great because they're not going to eat anything that sinks to the bottom, that type of thing. And it's definitely trial and error. You know, I've had employees, like Lamont had a faka puffer that hated the color red, just would not let anything red live, but could care less about anything else. So, you know, trial and error is what it's going to take probably. What do I do if I can't get my puffer to crush snails and clams? I don't really want to cut his teeth, but I feel like I might have to. There's nothing you can do, really. You can't force him to do it. The goal, hopefully, would be keep an eye on his teeth. Are they growing? Like, if you can visibly see them getting bigger, that's a problem. But maybe try offering freeze-dried krill. Like, a lot of our customers have good luck with freeze-dried krill that we sell on the website. And it's just crunchy enough to wear it down a little bit. Sometimes also, if the teeth are already big, it might not be able to open up enough to crush that snail. So that could be a problem as well. And Sean, it doesn't say what type of puffer. So for instance, pea puffers really wouldn't crush down clams. Even Amazon puffers aren't that big on the clams. They'll scrape the meat off. But they're not really designed to go through something that big. They will crush up snails, though. And a lot of times, puffers are picky. And so if you've been giving them just like, here, have candy, you know, bloodworms, live black worms, that type of thing, they can get lazy and go, well, maybe I don't feel like cracking the shell of a snail. So sometimes you have to fast them to get them back onto the right diets. Flynn asked, do I ever sell snails, frozen or live, to puffers to feed their fish? Yeah, we sell hundreds and hundreds every week. We, in fact, in the quarantine room in the store, have auto feeders set up, and we're purposely breeding snails as fast as we can because, one, our customers like to buy, and we sell them at 50 cents each. And I know that seems like a lot, but we go through so many that if we don't charge for them, we would just always be out. And we're actually, you know, we're using up space and putting employees in charge of breeding snails. So we have to recuperate some money there. Plus, when we get in puffers, we're deworming them and stuff like that, and they come in very skinny. So we're using a lot of snails, handfuls of snails, to get puffers up to weight before we sell them as well. So definitely we have to breed them just because, you know, snails are expensive. Even if you're buying mystery snails, that type of stuff, they're just expensive. And you'll run up a wicked food bill pretty quick if you're buying that kind of stuff to feed puffers that you're then going to sell. Please talk about pea puffer parameters. I would say neutral water, kind of, you know, maybe as low as 6.8, more like 7 to 7.6 or so. I'd say in that range would be good for pH. Moderate hardness. They don't mind tannin water, so if the water was a little brown, lots of plants, they love a planted tank. Also helps keep up with the waste they're going to produce because we're going to be feeding kind of messier foods. Moderate light, I wouldn't do a high light tank because that usually makes them more reclusive back into the corners and the darker spots. Tank mates, that's a real up in the air one. A lot of times, they just don't do well with tank mates, and then sometimes they do fine. Like right now in our sales tank, we've had it for almost 2 years now. We have a strawberry betta, we have orange shrimp, and we have nerite snail in there. And even though we keep moving through lots and lots and lots of pea puffers through there over the years, those have just been fine. So I don't know if they're smart enough or whatever it is, but then I could take some of those puffers out, put them in a different tank, and they'll murder all the snails. So again, different setups, and just kind of the more exciting you make it, the more they'll enjoy it. You know, if you put in a a castle. They're going to enjoy that castle. They're going to swim around it. And, you know, they love when things are changing. They love to go explore. Puffers are just that way. You know, they'll come up and see you at the glass, that type of thing. So the more you can do for them, the better. One of my best ways to kind of exercise and play with a puffer is a laser pointer. If you haven't done that yet, one of the best investments you'll ever make. Also for African cichlids and that type of stuff. Great way to interact with your fish and keep them healthy and active. Same with bettas too. But yeah, let's keep moving on. I want to hit some more stuff here. Let's see. How many pea puffers do I recommend for a 20-gallon with three German blue rams? I personally would recommend zero, because the German blue rams really should be at least 82 degrees. That's pretty warm. And what that's most likely going to do, and I say most likely because this could still work, that could turn it into where the metabolisms of the puffers are racing and they get more ornery and kind of get more territorial, that type of thing. And then also the food, like a lot of the frozen bloodworms and stuff you want to be feeding to those pea puffers aren't necessarily that good for the German blue rams, because they tend to get bloat fairly easy from something like that. So that kind of comes into that food thing again. You know, if you were going to try it, I would say try one, keep an eye on it, have a backup plan, those types of things. But in general, might be a harder setup to achieve there. But when it comes to pea puffers, the rule, I guess, online would be kind of 1 per 3 gallons of water. And I like to tell people with the minimum being 5 gallons of water. So if you have a 5-gallon tank, keep one. If you have a 10-gallon tank, maybe keep up to 3. On a 20-gallon tank, maybe you're keeping 6 or 7. And that's, you know, loose rules. Obviously, male and female ratios come into a play at a certain point when they hit sexual maturity. And so, there, you know, there's lots of things to talk about. We could do a whole hour stream probably on pea puffers, honestly. Almost any puffer. There's so many unique things. One of the places I would recommend getting some research would be Puffer Forum. I think it's pufferforum.net. That being said, they have a very particular way of doing things. And so take their advice with a grain of salt. You know, they strive for this is what we feel is perfection. Don't deviate from that. That being said, you can still extract a lot of very, very useful information. Let's see. Are there any puffers that can have a personality like a Mabou puffer that live in smaller tanks? Faaka puffers. And I feel like the ones that I've interacted with, Faaka puffer and then the Congo spotted puffer was pretty interactive, honestly. Amazons, I don't know. I feel like they're cool, but they're not like super interactive with the owner in my experience. On the whole, right? So if I take a group of 100 Amazon puffers, maybe 3 of them are super interactive and 97 aren't. Whereas on Faaka puffers and the Congo spotted puffer, they seem like most of them are. And so the Faaka puffer gets about 18 inches, which is a fairly decently big size fish for most people. And a Congo spotted puffer is more like 4 to 6 inches. So yeah. What puffer is good for a 20-gallon freshwater that's not aggressive? See, that's the thing, is like, there's not really a single puffer that's not aggressive. They all just have varying levels of aggressiveness. And the problem is their bite is deadly. So even like a Mabou puffer that lives with my guppies right now and shows no aggression, when he does show aggression, it'll just be a bloodbath. There's no holding back. So it's really hard to answer that question truthfully and say, well, you know, if you have your coveted angelfish, what puffer is going to do well with them? Well, if it's really coveted, don't add anything to it, honestly. But the ones that might work okay in a 20-gallon, I'm not sure there is going to be one. Well, if it was just the puffer, yeah, maybe one Amazon puffer, but really they like to be in groups. And possibly a Congo spotted puffer as well. Those would be my recommendations, but my recommendation would also be like, just get a bigger tank. And that's kind of the conversation we have at the store all day long, is talking people out of owning puffers, because they always want to take a puffer and put it into a small tank. And we look at it as like, you're buying a puffer. This is one of the most expensive fish you can really keep, because their diet is so expensive and just what they're going to need. So if you need to shoehorn a puffer into a 20-gallon, my response would be like, well, how about you choose the puffer you like and then buy the tank that best suits it? And so if you pick out a species that needs like a 40-gallon tank, great, buy a 40-gallon tank. That's going to be the cheap part. It's the food and the care long-term that becomes the expensive part on puffers. So, yeah. Let's see here. Can I put a pea puffer with my four black skirt tetras, eight neons, one loach, and one bristlenose in a 36-gallon heavily planted tank? Possibly. We run into that food issue again. Black skirt tetras, wicked quick to eat. The loach is going to want the same food definitely the pea puffer wants. So it could totally work. But if it doesn't work, my question to you is, what's your backup plan? Is that like, oh, I've got this tank over here, I'd return it to the store? You know, what's the backup plan? That's the important part, is if you're going to try something like that, and it, you might have like a 40% chance it works and a 60% chance it doesn't work, but what's the backup plan? That's the important part. Because if it works, great, nothing to worry about. But when it doesn't work, hopefully you go, oh, I've got this 10-gallon over here, it'd be perfect. So that's my advice there. What about a 40 breeder besides the pea puffer? I'm guessing you're asking what puffers can live in that. That would be like the arrowhead puffer, Murius Congo puffer, the spotted Congo puffer. You could do brackish water like figure eight and green spotted puffer. Amazon puffers you could do in there. You could do like the Cylon puffer. You could do a red-eyed puffer. And you could do avocado puffers as well. Those are all the ones I could think of that could probably do well in a 40 breeder. Talk about big freshwater puffers. Pretty much that's what I've been talking about. Mabu puffers and Faka puffers are the two largest species. Did you have any specific questions about them? So yeah, Flynn says, when I went down to your store, I noticed you had some nice red shrimp in Murphy's tank. Were they food or for display? If they're for display, does Murphy ever snack on them? So they're actually orange cherry shrimp. And you know in my fish room, I've got a ton of them, right? I took a bunch of them, right? And I was like, yeah, we'll feed them to him. It'll be a great snack. He ate like five, and the rest have just been living in there. And now that it's been like a year, I understand why. There's so much vegetation in the back, he can't swim through it. So it's like a big net. He can't get to there. So he just stopped trying. So there's a mono shrimp and there's orange cherry shrimp in there. And that just, you know, it's one of those things of, you know, well, he should be eating them, but he's choosing not to because we feed him so many clams and other stuff. He's going, ah, those things run away from me. If I wait 10 minutes, Corey will come feed me. And so he's used to that. And so, like, my current Mabu puffer will eat things like frozen brine shrimp and bloodworms, clams, and all that kind of stuff. Where my other puffer, he would only eat clams and frozen shrimp. That was it. We could never get him on anything else, no matter how hard I tried. And so, you know, even though same puffer, same tank, same water change schedule, same everything, very different personalities. Corey, a little off topic with the small puffers and a small tank. My wife has fallen in love with planted vases. Other than a betta, is there any nano fish that would work in a 2.5 to 5 gallon? On a 5 gallon, sure. 2.5, I have a hard time recommending anything just because it's such a small water volume. Maybe like scarlet batis, white clouds, maybe like a bumblebee goby. I know there's like got to be like 100 things. That's what I can think of off the top of my head. Maybe a couple of coolie loaches, like 3 coolie loaches in a 5 gallon. I know there's got to be more. I'm drawing blanks. So, what puffer should I get for a 30 gallon tank? See, that's the opposite. When it comes to puffers, go find the puffer you like and then buy the tank it needs to go in. Because just because I offer a suggestion for a 30 gallon tank, you might not want one that's totally brown, hides all day, and eats other fish. But it works out great in that 30 gallon. So I recommend finding the puffer you love, then building the environment for it. So yeah. What was the recommended tank size for Faka puffers? So, you know, this is up for a lot of debate, right? Let me start it with saying bigger is always better, okay? I personally believe A Faka puffer can be kept for quite a long time in a 75-gallon tank, with probably a more appropriate tank being either 120 gallons, so that's 4 feet by 2 feet front to back, or maybe a 125, that's 6 foot long by 18 front to back, or something like 180 gallon where it's 6 foot by 2 foot. But basically, I want at least 18 inches front to back, that's at least, and I would prefer 2 feet to give it some extra depth so you can get, you know, because we already established we want a lot of decor and stuff in a puffer tank. And if we've got a fish that's going to be 14, 16, 18 inches, and the tank's only 18 inches, how are we going to get all these cool things for him to explore and be able to turn around if he's already, you know, nose to tail in the tank? So I would go with the biggest tank you can put it in, honestly. I would love, you know, I love seeing Faka puffers in like the Marineland 300 gallon double deep. That's 36 inches. I feel like that's a paradise. Like my tank, for instance, with my Maboo puffer, I could go larger, right? Like money wasn't the object. I paid the same amount of money whether that tank was over 500 gallons or it was only 360 gallons. The problem in my store is physically someone has to be able to get around to the back area. So we could only make it 6 feet long, 4 feet front to back, and we could have made it taller, but that doesn't really improve their living space that much, you know. So if I have a tank that's 2 by 2 by 10 feet tall, that's actually horrible for them. It's more about surface area footprint as opposed to gallons of water. So, you know, everyone, well, I won't say everyone, but it's commonly quoted around the internet that Maboo puffers need at least 1,000 gallons of water, but no one quotes how big the tank needs to be dimensionally. Where, like, in my tank, we just change, you know, basically like 50% of the water every day. And so I could crank that up. I could change 5,000% of the water every day. So the water parameters for me are very easy because I have it automated. And people are, you know, they're using that 1,000-gallon number in an effort to make sure people are ready and committed to such a large puffer. But I think, you know, when we use blanket statements like that, we do cause some harm because there are people that maybe you have a 300-gallon tank and you have unlimited water changes going all the time. You could be a pretty good, you know, Maboo puffer keeper for a very long time, probably. Let's see. Why do some of the larger puffers like Maboo or Faka puffers accept small fish like guppies and rainbow fish? I can only guess why. My guess is that because they have a better food source, being, you know, the human that's going to dump food on them, they choose to eat there, and it's more work to chase down smaller fish and stuff. That being said, I know from firsthand experience, don't feed that Maboo or that Faka puffer for a week to 10 days. They'll start eating fish. They get hungry, and they'll eat. So, you know, you got to keep them well fed to keep them lazy. And I call it lazy, but... Are there poisons of the various puffers ever a danger to the keeper? So I'm not super well versed when it comes to the venom and toxins in the puffers. So this is only my firsthand experience. I've had where like a big Maboo puffer on their belly, you can feel the spikes sometimes. And unfortunately, when my first Maboo puffer, Hank, was passing away, I was doing stuff to try and save him. So at one point he had a swim bladder problem. I was trying to aspirate the swim bladder, which means taking a big needle and a relatively big gauge needle and get it right underneath the lateral line and just far enough in to his swim bladder to let the air out so he might be able to right himself. Well, while doing that, you're holding the fish and it's kind of moving around a bit. You know, it was at that point he was kind of weak, so it was super sad. Like, I don't even like to talk about it even today. I think the only time I've ever like cried like a baby for a fish, he's like a son to me, honestly. But the spikes on his stomach were rubbing against my hand as I'm doing this, and definitely for like the next day or two, my hand, like the palm of my hand, was itchy. But I've never been like stabbed full on with one, so I don't know how toxic. The most I've really heard about is people having that kind of itchy sensation, not so much life-threatening, but salt water could be a different thing for all I know. I don't know how venomous The ones that are going to be kept in actual aquariums are. So that's just what the ones, like, I've never had a problem with, like, pea puffers, Amazon puffers, that type of thing. Mostly, I think the biggest threat from puffers is their bite. You know, they come and just, boom, there goes your finger. You know, I do think that a Mubu puffer at the maybe foot to 2 feet mark, somewhere in there, could start taking bone off the fingertip. So I always recommend people be respect the animal for what it is and how powerful it is. And that's the best way to make sure you don't become the oops that just happened. And it's when people go, look at this, I can handle my puffer and he loves me and he'll do all this stuff. And eventually, you know, even your most loved dog that you've had for 10 years, you put it in the wrong scenario and it gets backed up into a corner and it thinks its life is about to end, will bite you. Even though it's never shown aggression in 10 years, slept by your side, you can put an animal in that situation. And so I always say respect the animal for how powerful they can be and try to never put yourself in a situation where they can do something harmful to you. Best puffer for a planted tank that's 120 gallons? Pea puffer, just one. It'd be a paradise. But really, I would say a good candidate, that might be a great tank for, let's say, a school, like a shoal of Amazon puffers. It might be a good tank for a Faka puffer if you're more liking that style of puffer, like a bigger one that's more aggressive. But if you like more of a community tank, maybe you go with the Amazons. The bigger the puffer, the more it's going to rearrange stuff. And like my Mabu puffer, when he's eating clams, if it lands on the plants, guess what? Plants just get chomped. So you got to decide what you like and what you want to keep and move on from there. I would say if you've never kept puffers before, start with smaller species because those are easier to rehome. You know, and that's what people don't realize is, like, what do you do when you have a 2 foot Mabu puffer and you decide, oh, I got to move across country? It's not really a pet you can just be like, oh, here, have it. Oh, yeah, you got a 55-gallon? It'll be fine. You know, it's a pretty dedicated animal. So know your life situation, you know, and know, am I really going to be able to take care of this pet? For me, like a Mabu puffer, to get one to about the age of 5 is about a $10,000 investment between food, the right tank, all the water changes, that type of thing. That doesn't include labor or anything, but that's just a reality of, you know, think about it like a Great Dane. Like when you get a Great Dane, you know it's going to have higher medical bills. You know it's not going to live as long. You know it's going to eat a ton. You know it's going to be destructive on your car because it's such a big animal. There's things you just know that come with the cost of owning something. And the bigger the puffer, the more you bring that with them. So let's see. Do figure eight puffers like to be alone or can they be with another figure eight puffer? I think it depends on how big the tank is. I would say the easier path is keeping them solo. If you had a large tank, it can work pretty well where you start having lots of territory so they can spread out. Any recommendations for changing up puffers' diets? It's really hard. They get to be really picky, so fasting them. So maybe they don't eat for a week, and then you're trying to put them with something. To get them on a dry foods, if you can get them eating like frozen shrimp, you can start kind of flaying them and putting pellets in there. That's worked for some people. One tip I tried, I haven't got it to work yet with my Mabu puffers, was taking clams and filling it with her pashy food. Neither of them really took to it. But you got to kind of just get inventive, you know. Just think like, how could I make this work? Sometimes, like, let's say you find your puffer loves bloodworms. Take frozen bloodworms and soak it with pellets. And then feed the pellets and see if that scent will get them to start eating it. You got to kind of just keep trying things till, you know, you find out what's going to work for that puffer. And that's really, I can't stress that enough, is each puffer is different, not just by species, but even if I have 2 Mabu puffers, they are so different. Could a pea puffer take a good chunk out of your finger if it was really mad? I think so. I mean, they've got a decent bite. I know African cichlids can at least leave a red mark, so I think they could at least do that. I don't know if it could take a decent chunk, but at the same time, I would defer back to the respect the animal and not learn, like, turns out they can go right through your finger. That was dumb, you know, kind of try to. And really, for me, I never want to put the animal in that situation. Like, I've got little chihuahuas, right? But I would feel guilty if I put them in a situation where they feel like they needed to bite me. Same thing for my fish. If I put them in a situation where I feel like they need to bite me, I don't like to do that. So for instance, when we have them in the store, if they're really aggressive while we're cleaning algae or something, I feel bad because they're not really doing that out of like, I just want to bite you. They're doing it out of fear. And so we're causing fear while we do that. And so in general, long term, I'd be finding a way like a much larger tank and things to alleviate that. Because really what they would love to do is like, oh God, big hands coming in. They're like, oh geez, let me get out of here. Let me go hide back in this corner. But if you don't provide them with a large enough tank, it's kind of that flight or fight response. If they can't run, they have to fight. So I've heard that puffers are more sensitive to medication. Are there certain meds specifically to avoid? Do we need to dose less with general cure and erythromycin? So I'm sure there are meds that are more toxic to puffers than other fish. Kind of a question I ask 100 times a day that I find super annoying is, do we dose less with general cure, erythromycin, ICX, that type of stuff? No. Every fish, every time, gets dosed the same amount. If you use half-strength general cure, it just half doesn't kill the parasite. Like, they're already in the minimum strength. So when you half-dose a medicine, it just doesn't work. That's the problem. Do I use general cure and erythromycin? Definitely. Every fish I ever come in contact with gets those meds in addition to ICX. I would not use half strength because that doesn't actually do what it's supposed to do at that point. And, you know, it's kind of like if a human, you know, like let's say you have pneumonia and you have an infection that's going to kill you. They don't give you half strength meds to get rid of the infection. If anything, they would give you more meds because they know you're that much weaker. And it's the same thing with fish, is like, that's like the minimum level we need to use to treat these things. But there are, you know, here's the biggest problem when it comes to medicines for me. I have medicines that I know and I use hundreds of thousands of times a year, and I'm really well versed with them. And if you just pull random medicine off the counter somewhere and you go, hey, does this work? I've probably never used it with any of those puffers. So it could be horrible, or it could be the best medicine ever made for deworming puffers. The problem is I don't have the experience, and so it's really hard for me to tell you, watch out for that, don't watch out for that. I don't know of anything that is like crazy bad specifically to puffers, or anything that's crazy good. If I knew something was crazy good, I would be using it. But yeah, I can't think of anything. So really, in my opinion, there's medicines that are harsh and there are medicines that aren't harsh. So copper-based medicines tend to be harsh on fish, not just scaleless fish or anything like that. Just in general, are kind of harsh. The one medicine I can think of that are good for puffers, so like let's say your figure eight puffer has ick. If you put marine salt in there and raise the salinity, that's going to kill off the ick and is also good for the puffer. Now that being said, if you had an Amazon puffer, I would not recommend using marine salt to cure that ick. But in the few instances where you're treating like a brackish water puffer, salt could be very, very beneficial as opposed to a medication, I think. Are target puffers abundant in the hobby? I see them every once in a while. I wouldn't say they're super duper abundant from what I've seen, but I'm not really looking for them either, I suppose. Let's see. If you drop the water level tank in half, do you use half as many meds? Yes, you would. You dose based on water volume. Let's see here. I keep my puffer in a 1 gallon tank, but do water changes every 15 minutes. Is that okay? Yes, that's perfectly fine. It's been proven actually in labs that if you can change the water all the time, it's actually fine. Chemically, it's fine. I realize what you're trying to do there. You're trying to be funny, but if we're going to waste people's time, let's actually, you know, bring up the studies where they've studied growth of goldfish and stuff like that, where they never saw the same water twice. They actually grew the fish so big that they were all touching and could keep moving, and it did not impact their growth at all. So the reality is, yes, you could do it, but you know, you would get into the fact that I could raise a dog and never let it out of the closet. That doesn't make it humane, but could it physically live there if I always cleaned up after it and fed it every day? Sure, horrible life, but we could do it. Amazon puffers, how much flow is optimal, and do they need to graze on the word I can never pronounce? What is that? It's almost like a sound, like off. I don't know how to say that word, but they typically aren't big grazers on, you know, algae and detritus and stuff like that. They want to graze on inverts is what they want to do, little inverts all day long. I don't think they need a lot of flow. In my opinion, they actually like the fast lane they can go play in, and then they also like most of the tank being slow so they can just dirtle around and do what puffers do. Do pea puffers like hard water? I don't know if they specifically like it. They can do okay in hard water. The definition of hard water being, well, you know, maybe 300 parts per million. If it was, you know, 1,000 parts per million, it's like, well, that's really hard. So, yeah. What is the reason that puffers are given really large feeding and then fasted? Is that better for them or lighter feedings daily? So I personally don't fast my puffers. I feed them every day. I think where the big feeding and fasting came from was a lot of people like to mimic nature. And so nature, the puffer goes out, it eats a big meal, and then goes and basically hides for the rest of the week until it's hungry again. It's a survival thing of, you know, if every time I needed to eat, I had to go out in the yard, but I got shot at by snipers, I would limit the amount of times I needed to eat based on trying not to die. In our aquariums, I don't feel like we're setting up the opposite, basically. We're setting up the buffet. So I think smaller meals more frequently is definitely better for growth rates. And it could be argued whether growing a fish faster or slower is better technically. But I think meals in moderation with a wide variety is probably best most often. And I realize it's a super general statement, but, like with headbangers, which would be, you know, big aggressive Central and South American cichlids, how do you keep them super aggressive? You feed them once a week. And so they're constantly on the hunt. And so you can put your hand over the glass and they'll bash into it. Whereas if you feed them every day, they're much more mellow. And I personally prefer to keep my fish more mellow, just from a personal preference, not from a, I think that's the right way to do it or the wrong way. But I don't like to watch my fish hunt my other fish because that's not an enjoyable scenario for me. So I typically just like them to eat the food I provide. Let's see here. Are Corys good tank mates with Amazon puffers? Typically, they do okay. I don't know if I could put them in the category of, like, these are specifically good for them. But the people that are keeping them with them haven't reported much problem. So I think you're okay with it. That's my initial, you know, with that being said, everything's a problem with puffers, you know. Think of puffers like a cat. You know how cats are just like, oh, look at that. There's that thing that should totally be fine. Let me knock that off onto the floor. Like, they're just, they do whatever they want, and they don't care. So one day, they love corridors. The next day, they're like, oh, he just bought 10 more corridors? Teach him. He's moving people in on my territory. You know, they just do what they want and build the tank around them. Here's the way I like to go into it. Set up a tank for your puffers. Then everything you add, assume it's expendable or at least at risk, and keep an eye on it, and if something's going wrong, fix it. But what everyone does is they go into it with that mentality, and then 8 months later, they're going, he's never ate anything, just go ahead, throw that $100 fish in there. And then they're all mad that the next day he ate a $100 fish. Well, he never ate any of those other fish. They can do what they want, you know, if they're not, you know, it's kind of like flipping a coin. You flip a coin, it comes up tails. The next flip, it's no more likely to be heads or tails again, even though we think, oh, odds are better. Just because he's lived with 100 fish for the last year doesn't mean the next fish he doesn't absolutely hate. So it's really hard. Just, you got to know going in, there's odds. You can have better and worse odds, but they're still odds. I really like Mabu puffers. What's my favorite type? My favorite type is Mabu puffers for sure. I think my second favorite type might be those Congo spotted puffers. I've been really considering maybe putting one here in the studio just because at the shop, I keep going, oh, that thing's cool. But, you know, I haven't brought one home yet because they've been selling so fast. I live by my own rule at the store. Has to be in the store for a week before I get it. The last one, it sat there for a week and Kaylee got it. The person that ships all your guys' orders, she got it. So we'll probably be doing some filming and stuff like that. She's been doing some really cool stuff since she joined the team at Aquarium Co-op. She's got better rubra fry breeding. She shared it on Tank Talk, a beautifully aquascape tank, in my opinion, anyway. So I've been harassing her to do a viewer home show so we could either A, I come over and film, or B, she should submit some of her tanks. And then we eventually want to get her here on the live stream. She's newer to the hobby in the last couple of years or whatever, but is obsessed like we all are, so she's learning lots. And because she works at a fish store, she's learning, you know, faster than most would. And she's playing with some very cool fish, and she does lots of research. So that's why she's been so successful so far, I think. Let's see. What are common growth rates and max size for Amazon puffers? I feel like they grow moderately slow because most people can't afford to feed them correctly. With what that means, like lots of snails and stuff like that. The other thing of the size there, like I think in books and stuff, they say they hit 4 to 6 inches. I've never seen, that's 4 inches there. I've never seen one that big. I've seen a ton of them at 3 inches, and I feel like that's super common. Whereas I feel like a solid 4-inch Amazon puffer, I'd be like, dang, that thing was eating its Wheaties. I just haven't seen one in person yet. I'm not saying it doesn't exist, but I've never even seen a wild-caught one come in that big. So I feel like that's stretched out a little bit. That being said, I'm sure there's 5 people in chat going, this guy doesn't know anything. I got 12 Amazon puffers that are 4 feet long right now. You know, I'm just saying I haven't seen it in person. So my general statement would be, they get about 3, maybe 3.5 inches, and usually you're going to buy them at about this big, and a year later they'll be like that big, and a year later they'll be that big. So they're growing like 1/2 inch a year, maybe, roughly. Are there any puffers that I regret keeping? Usually I regret pea puffers because they're not big enough for what I like. And I usually keep them because other people want me to keep them, not because I really like them, if that makes any sense. I haven't kept that many puffers because most of them I know I don't like. Like a hairy puffer, I think they look super cool, but I also think they're kind of a brown turd, which means they just kind of sit there and they hunt stuff. And I know that's super interesting to me for probably the first 6 months. And then the next 16 years I have that puffer, I'm probably bored of it. So I don't keep that species of puffer myself. That being said, I have customers that keep them and they show me videos and pictures and I'm always super intrigued going, wow, that guy's amazing. Why don't I have one of those? And then I think about it long and hard and I go, well, I'm only going to keep so many puffer fish at any one time. These are the ones I want to work with is what I come back to most times. Let's see here. Do you have to cut their teeth? The whole goal with feeding a puffer correctly would be that you don't have to. If you get into a situation where you do have to, yep, you have to basically put them under, trim them, and that's pretty traumatic and not fun. But the goal is that we wouldn't have to do that. And that brings up another point I want to talk about. People are very, very worried about getting their puffers enough shelled food. It's more important when the puffer is closer to full grown than it is when it's young. So for instance, if you have a Mubu puffer and it's this big, okay, and it's going to grow to be this big, you know, like huge. If its teeth grow a little bit big, but it grows this big, the teeth are growing proportionally. Like a Mubu puffer that's this big, its teeth are tiny, right? And then a Mubu puffer that's this big, its teeth are like this. So it's when that puffer is this big, you know, you really got to watch those teeth. Or, you know, or that Amazon puffer is this big, you really want to keep a close eye on it. As they're still growing, you've got more time. It's when they really slow down in growth that you really want to make sure, because their teeth, you know, are going to grow at a certain rate no matter what, but their bodies are going to fill in at the same time. It's when those aren't in sync that you really run into problems and really want to make sure you're doing a lot of shelled foods. I want to get 3 Amazon puffers. What size tank and what type of setup? So my first advice is do 1 Amazon puffer or a group of 5 or 6 at the minimum. At 3, it could be a bloodbath. It could also be perfect. You could get a male and 2 females and wow, they're making babies and you're a millionaire. Or it could be a total bloodbath also. Your odds, I think, just get better either way you go. Keep just 1 or keep a bigger group. In general, I would say tank size 55 gallon would be great. You know, if you're keeping just 1, maybe 29 gallon, 40 breeder. Lots of maybe sticks or rock along with lots of live plants would kind of fill it in nice. Give them lots of areas to explore. Just got an Amazon puffer yesterday. Won't eat. What do I do? The best thing I found is to, 1, it depends on how skinny they are. If they're super skinny, put live snails in and put in maybe live blackworms. Get them to start eating. Get some weight on them. If they're not super skinny, go ahead and start deworming them. Sometimes they don't want to eat because they've got so many internal tapeworms that they just feel bad. So getting that out of them usually gets them eating more. Those would be the 2 ways I would start. You can always email me or something or a Facebook message and we could talk more about it. But that's probably what I would start with. And if you just got it, realize it can take weeks for a puffer to settle in. Because they're like, you know, watching all their, you know, surroundings. So they got to learn, you know, they're looking for the snipers in the trees before they go out and eat. So, let's see. It looks like we need more puffer questions. Which puffer tastes best? I don't know. I didn't try any when I was in Japan. You know, I could have. I just chose not to. And it's not even from a like, oh, I don't think we should do that. I'm not sure that from everyone I talked to that's actually had it, they're like, yeah, I don't know. It didn't taste that good. And it's expensive, too, you know, to eat puffer. So it wasn't like cheap. How do you deworm them? That's a good point. I should have covered that in the beginning. So it's very, very important that you deworm your puffers because most puffers are wild caught and they tend to just have lots of tapeworms and internal parasites. So my favorite method is to start with General Cure or Prozzy Pro, which General Cure has praziquetanol in it. It also has metronidazole. I basically do a round of that. Then I go, you know, maybe up to 3 months, put a lot of body weight on them. Then I might go with another type of dewormer and I deworm them again. And my goal is usually deworm them about 4 times with 4 different meds before I kind of consider them clean. And maybe one of those is levamisole or flubendazole. Maybe one of them is like Tetra's Parasite Guard. You can dissolve that into the food. That's a common one that's done on the puffer forums. But really, what I don't want to have happen is I don't want to really fall in love with a puffer. And then year 3, it's super duper sick because it's got tapeworms. And now I'm using medicines and I accidentally kill it. That hurts way more than if you spend the first year of its life getting it super duper healthy. And then from that point on, you've got a clean bill of health and you can really just grow them and make them thrive. Let's see. Any idea where I can get red-eyed puffers? I'd probably watch Aquabid or the Wet Spot. They're the most likely ones to probably bring them in. That'd be where I'd be watching. Do you put pea puffers under with clove oil? You can. MS-222 is better. But clove oil, it can be done with that. Yep. Hi, I have a 20-gallon long with 3 neons, 1 thread fin, a cobalt blue goby. Can I keep a pea puffer with it? Kind of goes back to the beginning there of, it sounds like you've set up a 20-gallon tank for all those other fish, and now you want to add a puffer. Really, you should start the other way around of saying, I want a pea puffer. How could I set up the best tank for it? And, you know, I personally would say maybe you need to add some more neon tetras to your neon tetra school. Same with your threadfin rainbow school. The other things that might come into play, the threadfin rainbows, because they have those thread fins, might look like worms. That might antagonize the pea puffer. So there's a lot kind of going on with that tank, and adding a pea puffer to that mix might not make things any easier, might make it really difficult. So I would, you know, really think long and hard before I would just drop that guy in there. Let's see. What can I do to not have cloudy water? Help my fish keep stressing and keep dying. Probably you might have a bacterial bloom going on. It might mean you have ammonia or nitrite in the water. I would start with, if you're not already, test kits. See what's going on in the water. Maybe you need to change water. Could also be that you need to change less water. Some people get trapped and they're changing so much water that it's really, really adverse to them as well. But that's where I would start. I'd look at the water is where I would look. Are you sure we can use levamisole with pea puffers? No, I'm not sure, but I've never had a fish I couldn't use levamisole with. So, I mean, I've used it, but it's not like I've done it 100,000 times like I have the other meds. But I personally have never had a problem with levamisole in any fish ever. Same with flubendazole as well. Now, it's definitely harmful on, like, snails and stuff like that, but I have not had any problems with fish. Let's see. Have Mabu puffers been bred in captivity? Are they live bearers? As far as I know, they're egg scatterers. Well, that's not true. I don't know if they're an egg scatterer. They're an egg layer. And I don't know of them being bred in captivity. Fa'aka puffers are being bred in captivity. They're bred in ponds now. But I haven't heard of any of the Mubu puffers being bred in captivity. That being said, maybe, you know, like I haven't looked in probably a couple of years. So maybe in the last year they've done it or something. But I still feel like they're all coming in wild caught from what I see. How big do pea puffers get? They get like the size of like a dime. Like, yeah, that's what I would... That's the best way. I usually, like in a store, I pull out a dime and I go, they get to that right there. That's what they are. But since I don't have a dime, that doesn't make sense right now. But not very big. That's the lure of them. They don't get very big, but they are still a puffer, you know? So they could still be, yeah. What tank size for Tetradon Sheldentii? Obviously, perfect world, bigger is better. I feel like a 29-gallon or a 40 breeder would be pretty decent. What's my email so we can talk more? store@aquariumcoop.com. It's on our website. You can also go through Facebook. There's, you know, pretty much a million ways to reach me. Is the stream going to be about puffers for the entire duration, or are we switching to general questions? I might take some general questions as I'm wrapping it up, because I usually try to help illness questions, because I just feel like, you know, I don't want to make someone wait a whole week and they're like, my fish died, dang it, you know, so I try to help. Can Amazon puffers be bred in captivity? I think that answer is yes. I think they're starting to be bred in captivity, because there's been some really small ones coming in that I've seen lately, and they've been more available than ever in years past. That being said, I haven't done any actual research to see if they're being like hormone bred or if they're just being able to import more than they used to. So, are pea puffers considered scaleless fish? Yeah, I need to do a whole video about scaleless fish. Scaleless fish aren't scaleless, they just have a different type of scale structure. It's more like skin, you know. So, but yeah, I don't even know why the big thing about scaleless fish exists, because you don't treat them any differently. Like, they think they're less hardy and stuff like that. Their skin is just different, that's all. In my experience, they're no less hardy than other fish that aren't considered scaleless. So, how do I keep pea puffers, and how big of a tank should I use? We covered that earlier, so if you're late to the party, if you rewatch the stream, that'll fill you in. Let's see. Corey, will you ever sell shrimp online, even for a short time? I can't find a reasonably priced, reliable seller for orange and blue shrimp. So I would never say never. I have no plans of doing it currently, and I would encourage you to go buy them from LR Brett's, Lucas. LR Brett's Aquatics, that's where I got my blue shrimp. They came in great. I think he's more than reasonably priced. If, you know, if he would let me, I would tell him, raise your price. You're selling too cheap. Your quality is amazing. Not only that, you're getting shrimp that are winning awards. So even though, like, my shrimp, don't get me wrong, I love them, my shrimp aren't winning awards. So I'm not entering them into anything. You can buy basically award-winning shrimp at a very cheap price, in my opinion, from LR Brett. So, you know, check out his channel, too. He's got a thriving YouTube channel. I would send you there, and I go there to buy shrimp if I need something myself. So, let's see. Have I heard of a golden avocado puffer? I have one you can show the viewers. Yeah, I've heard of them. Yeah, avocado puffers. Yep. They're, I don't know, they kind of got more of an elongated body, and they've got the wider belly to them, and yeah. Do I ship puffers? I do not. Can a puffer have ick? It certainly can. Yep. And I would treat it like I normally would with ick X. Mm-hmm. What's a good setup for a red spotted or a red eyed puffer? They can go in like a 20 high. Tan and water is kind of nice. You know, darker climate, not climate, darker environment. Wood and plants and that type of thing works pretty well. What makes a breeder tank a breeder tank? That's a good question. So breeder tanks, the theory being all breeders care about is footprint. So they're usually like a breeder tank is usually deeper front to back and long and then not very tall. So breeders like to stack racks of tanks, as many as they can fit. And breeders allow more space for breeding. And that's kind of where it got the whole breeder thing. Levamisol is not supposed to be used on scaleless fish as per the directions on the internet. Yep, there's a lot of stuff on the internet that makes no sense. So, for instance, if we're not using it for scaleless fish, how come levamisol is the only known cure to stop skinny disease in clown loaches? Like, that's levamisol essentially came about to treat clown loaches. So, them being a scaleless fish, quote-unquote, you know, that's the problem. The problem is lots of stuff gets said on the internet and it's all someone's opinion. So if I take levamisol and I treat 10 million puffers and it never kills one and I say it's puffer safe and people believe me, it's now puffer safe. If I take levamisol and I try to treat one pea puffer and it kills it and I say levamisol kills puffers and people believe me, now it's a fact. So in my experience, I've never had a problem with levamisol on any fish ever, actually. And I've used it on quite a bit of different things. In fact, someone was trying to treat their guppies or something like that with levamisol, and they showed me the website, and the video on there was laughable. And then it said, don't use with cardinal tetras, neon tetras, and it listed a bunch of fish that I personally have used it on a ton and never had a problem. So it's always opinion-based, and that's the problem with the internet, is that when you read something as a fact, it doesn't mean it's a fact. Just because I say fact, this is known to kill humans, doesn't mean it actually kills humans. It just means that I said it kills humans. And so, you know, the other thing is, if you read about levamisol, there's probably 50 different methods to use it, different dosage rates, different, you know, like the website the guy was claiming that he bought it from and everything recommended dosing it once, then waiting for 3 weeks and dosing again. In my experience, that doesn't work. I use the method that Greg Sage uses, and that is dose, water change, dose the next day, then wait 2 weeks, dose again, and that will usually get it. That being said, that's what works for me. If the other methods work for you, just fine. If you don't want to use levamisol on a scaleless fish, great, don't. You know, that's the only thing is you can take in information, you can sort it through your own brain and analyze what you want to do. But for instance, if your puffer had Camelanus redworm, how would you get rid of it? Without levamisol, it's pretty much impossible. You could maybe use flubendazole, but flubendazole is so close to levamisol that I would just use levamisol. So that's my rant about stuff like that. And the funny part is, rewind 5 years ago, no one knew like anything about levamisol. So it's been an arms race. Levamisol has been a giant arms race to be, I'm the guy that's going to supply levamisol and charge people through the nose to fix their fish. And, someone, you know, and then you start selling it, you're like, oh man, it killed all that guy's cardinal tetras. Okay, we'll put it, it's not cardinal tetra safe now. We'll keep selling it. You know, not many people are going to go like, oh yeah, I'm going to use this on an entire fish farm and see what does and doesn't work. So what's the average lifespan of an Amazon puffer kept in proper conditions? That's a bit like asking, how long does a cardinal tetra live? If it's, well, most Amazon puffers are going to be wild caught. And so it might already be 4 years old before you get it. So I feel like one, I've never kept one its entire life, but I feel like the correct answer to that question is probably somewhere between 5 and 10 years, you know, with us being the one that kills it. Like, oh, power outage. Oh, I got lazy and didn't feed enough shelled food. And then it got too skinny. And then I killed it when I tried to give it, try to put it under with clove oil or something like that. That's usually the way a puffer dies, is human error. And that's most fish, not just puffers, by the way. Like, most fish die from human error, not from like, oh man, he lived to be 27. Let's see. I want a puffer fish and avocado. Well, it's kind of picked by my sister, but she's not feeling well. We read online, it's okay, but is it? I want a puffer fish and avocado. Is it okay with something, I suppose? Yeah. I feel like I'm missing part of that. Let's see. I use Panicure C to deworm my puffers. I add the Panicure to thawed bloodworms and shrimp and then refreeze it. I feed the frozen bloodworms to the fish. It has to bite the medicine off to get the food. Yeah. So Panicure C, I believe the active ingredient is fenbendazole, not flubendazole. And you can buy it, I think it like PetSmart and Petco. It's just used in normal dog dewormer. I think Target, not the store Target, but I think it's, I feel like Target brand is on there or something like that. But yeah, and that's the thing, is I use a variety of dewormers to make sure I've gotten it all, because different deworming agents treat different types of worms and intestinal parasites. So let's see. I catch ghost shrimp anytime I want in Florida. Any problems? There could be. I would say your risk is very low of actually introducing something. The best thing you could do would be catching ghost shrimp from brackish water and feeding them to a freshwater puffer. Very little would transfer over there. Best vitamin supplement for puffers you mentioned at the beginning of the live stream? Probably like Vitachem. Hikari makes one. I think Boyd Enterprises makes one. I don't know that it's important that you get the best one. I think it's important that you get one. So, for instance, if I don't take any multivitamins in my life, it's not as important for me to find the best multivitamin, when the reality is, like, if I take any of them, it's a huge improvement. And a lot of people will even use things like the liquid baby vitamins to do it. Yeah. So I would say just find one. Any one that you could really pull off the shelf is going to be a huge improvement. So go with whatever is easily accessible to you. Is it worth growing your own brine shrimp and bloodworms? And how do you grow them? Well, how you grow them, that's like a whole different like video on its own. Brine shrimp, for most people, I feel like it's not going to be worth your time to raise them to adulthood. It can be a fun project during the summer for sure. Do it outside. It's fun to do it, but it's not practical. So I would say if you've never done it, it'll be fun. Do it. But long term, you'll be like, ah, that's a lot of work. Bloodworms, you can get the red aquatic worms going. I tend to get them going in my Daphnia cultures. There again, so much work would go into it for such little yield. Probably not worth it for you. Will Amazon puffers kill each other? Hold on. Will Amazon puffers kill each other? Amazon puffers in a puffer-only tank? Not any more than any other fish would. So, like, if the ratio is wrong, if you have three males, they're going to be really hard on each other. Male and two females might be okay. The bigger the group, with the bigger the tank, the better your odds get of everyone getting along. You know, so for instance, if I import 24 puffers and I keep them in 30 gallons of water, they're going to have nipped tails. If I take that same group of puffers and I put them into a 55, there'll be a lot less stress. And if it's planted, that's even better. So, you know, space is always at a premium. Can you put discus with puffers? I've seen some people do it, but long term, I don't feel like it works out very well because you're really cranking up the metabolism on those puffers. Best substrates for figure eight and avocado puffer. For me personally, I think the best substrates for puffers is the cichlid, cichlid sand, like Ivory Coast. Basically, it's got fine crushed coral mixed into the coarser sand. That's my favorite. If I have 120 gallon, how many avocado pufferfish could live in it? I don't know. They're pretty feisty. Like, the answer might be one. It could also be like four, but they're more aggressive of a species and don't necessarily like each other. What breed of puffer can live in a 75? Quite a few. I would say Amazons, pea puffers, hairy puffer, Congo, the red one, or Murius puffer, Congo spotted puffer, arrowhead puffer, maybe shoehorning a Faka puffer in there, figure eight, and my brain starting to stop working. That was intelligent. So I said figure eight, green spotted puffer, Cylon puffers, avocado puffer or puffers, probably a few more. You've got a lot of options. The problem is, like, let's say on the hairy puffer, the Murius puffer, stuff like that, you're only going to get one. Like, they're so aggressive, only one's going to live in there. And a lot of people might say, like, well, that's not really worth a whole 75-gallon tank. And, yeah, that could be true. Do puffers live better alone or with another puffer? Most puffers do better solo than they do with others. That being said, you know, if you want to breed pea puffers, you're going to have to put them together. You know, I think if you avoid small tanks, so like if you take pea puffers and you put them in a 55-gallon tank, I think more the merrier. If you, you know, want to put a bunch of pea puffers in a 20-gallon tank, like, well, don't go too crazy. Where's Murphy's gills? It looks like he has none. Yeah, they kind of have, they have gills, but they're like openings, you know, because I really want to be able to like blast water. So they're, I don't know how to explain it, but they're like openings and they can use it just to like force water through. But they don't really have big gill plates or anything like a normal fish would. Let's see. Baby brine shrimp for fry? Yeah, good thing, yeah. Can a puffer live with a Jack Dempsey? I can't think of any puffers that I could say, like, that's a good combo. Could it be done? Yeah, it could, but I feel like, you know, it's pretty hard to do. I like to explain to people, like, I mean, yeah, you can keep a Great Dane in a studio apartment on the 25th floor of an apartment building, but maybe you wait till you own a house to do that. Kind of the same thing, like, maybe you just set up a puffer tank and it's super easy. Let's see. My dwarf puffer won't eat frozen foods. Is there anything I can do to get him to start eating? Can be hard. What is he eating right now? Just snails? Usually fasting them is the best way, and offering them, like, if you can get live blackworms, transitioning onto that, it's easier to transition then to frozen bloodworms if that's what your goal was. Let's see. I don't know the ABI puffer. Are ABI puffers true freshwater? ABI. I don't know that puffer. I know the, what do they call them? Like the Fugu puffer is actually a brackish water puffer. It looks super cool though. 3D printed aquarium equipment. I've seen some. In fact, I've got some stuff I still need to play with. I've got it in the garage. Someone made me a CO2 reactor and a... man, my brain is like ready to turn off. Caldness Media Reactor. Made me both those. I just haven't played with them enough. Cole asks, do you know why the Congo Spotted Puffer commands such a high price? Civil unrest or limited collection area? So it was that it was a conflict zone and no one wanted to go collect them, right? That was like the last 20 years. Now, I honestly feel like what's going to happen is that price is going to go down by like $20 every 6 months. And it's because I haven't been there. So it's not like I went and looked and said like, oh, there's billions of these things, But I suspect right now they're commanding a high price because so many buyers are out there. When that pool shrinks and dries up a bit, the prices are naturally going to start coming down a little bit. And I think it'll settle out around about $100 puffer is where I think it'll settle out, maybe 80. But right now, I think we sell them for 180 or something like that, and they sell really quick. So I think until that stops happening, there's no reason that the wholesalers and stuff like that are ever going to lower the price. Hey, Corey, I heard Faka puffers grow slow. I have one, and it has got some growth, but not a lot. I think puffer growth rate is directly proportional to the amount of vitamins they're getting and how good their water quality is. So a lot of times we'll feed puffers a lot, but they're not getting a lot of vitamins because it's so many clams or shrimp or something like that, but they're missing some of the essential vitamins to grow. And then also sometimes we're not doing it nearly enough water changes to really get maximum growth. That being said, my first Maboo puffer took forever to grow. My second Maboo puffer grew like a weed. Now, I attribute that to, I know a lot more about Maboo puffers than I did the first time around. And because I'm doing those 100-gallon plus water changes every single day, and I'm making sure he gets a wider variety of diet and things like that, I think his growth pattern has been faster than my previous one. Will puffers eat land snails? I suspect they would. I would be a little bit careful to make sure they haven't picked up any pesticides or anything like that as they were crawling around. Do I ever worry that Murphy will choke on clams or crabs? I don't. They're made to do that. I get nervous when I watch him swallow a whole clam because sometimes it'll take him a day or two to get that to come out of his anus, and it's unsightly. It looks painful, and every customer's like, is he okay? And all I have to say is, like, they're designed to do that. He could technically get impacted, but he pretty much always, passes them without incident. So, you know, this... Yeah, it's one of those things. I've had to remove a piece of clam from a puffer's anus before. So, like, on a Maboo puffer, you'd be surprised how big their anus is. I've had my finger in there pulling it out. That's not something you put on the job resume. Like, oh, I've pulled stuff out of the rectum of a puffer fish. But, you know, as a certified fish nerd, you get into situations that, you know... Not many people know that. I mean, everyone knows that now, but, you know, that's some of the gross stuff you got to do for your pets, right? Do anything to save a life. Let's see. Can you replace a broken aquarium frame with a 3D printed one? I suspect you might be able to. The problem, I think, would come down to the actual material you use. There's so many materials you could use in a 3D printer. I don't know which one would handle the stress / which ones would be okay for the water, not react, that type of thing. How much dwarf Sagittarius should I order off your website to start a carpet on a 240-gallon tank? Also, will get easy green. I have the LED rope light fixture. So my honest advice is one pot of it. And it's because I am as cheap as they come. And I know it's either going to thrive or it's going to die. If it's thriving, it's going to carpet out. And it might take you a year, right? And if you're going, well, dang it, I don't want to wait that long. As long as it's moving in the right direction, order some more. It'll speed it up. But if I tell you order 20 pots and you kill it all with that DIY light, I've just wasted a lot of your money. So if you order one and it's thriving and it's not growing as fast as you want it to grow, then you could buy some more. But I'm big on take it slow, make sure it's thriving, and then move on. What are your thoughts on a Maboo puffer at 30-inch cylinder tank? I don't think it's optimal. One, technically the fish could outgrow that tank in terms of actual length. Two, 30-inch round, what I imagine is that puffer gets bigger. I imagine the Austin Powers scenes where he's stuck in the hallway on like the golf cart thing where he's just as it moves around to try and do anything. And I think I could I could physically keep a fish alive in there, but it comes down to, do I want to? And that's your own moral decision there. I'm not going to say whether you can or can't do that. I personally wouldn't do that. Hey, there's LR Brett's. So, Neon, you're looking for shrimp. Hit him up right there. Let's see. Tips or tricks on how to take aggression down for a Faka Puffer. I feed my 3-inch Faka Puffer twice a day, and he likes to bite other fish. He might just be a killer, so know that. Sometimes there's nothing you can do. But one of the best things you can do is out of sight, out of mind. The more stuff in the tank, the less he can see the fish. So if you had a planted jungle everywhere, he might not see the fish swimming over here. And when he does, he goes, oh, and then they're gone again, right? So that would be the first thing, I think. I'm trying to think of what else. You could also, like with turtles, for instance, you can use feeder fish, and eventually you'll get feeder fish that are smart enough to survive. So let's say you try zebra danios, right? And you put 10 in there and he eats 7 of them the first night. Then you put 10 more in there the next day and he eats 7 again. So now you got 6, but they're getting pretty smart. They're like, hey, this guy is on to me. He's chasing me. And if you keep doing that day after day after day, you might end up with a group of danios that are good at evading the Faka Puffer. So those are my tips. What pufferfish has the longest lifespan? That I don't know, because I've never kept them long enough in captivity to witness that. And I think anything we would, you know, read about is hearsay. Just, you know, so, you know, it's like when you read about, let's say, I always like to cross things to other animals. Like, how long does a dog live? Well, someone's chihuahua might live to be 12 and the next one might live to be 22. So that's a huge range. And depending on who you're talking to, you know, is the different information you're going to get. So could come down to genes, could come down to how you kept that dog, that type of thing. Same with the puffer. I think 10 to 15 years is doable for most people. I bet you could push it, you know, like in public zoos and stuff, I bet you they can push it to 20, 30 years on a lot of them. That being said, that's not from me knowing that answer. That's just from me speculating that typically in very large systems, fish can live a lot longer. Let's see. Is there any questions that need to be answered? Like, oh my God, this is a 911. Because I'm going to start wrapping this up. And I want to, you know, any illness questions, stuff like that. I think we're kind of circling around on these puffers back to individual things here. Do I think a 90-gallon for one Faka Puffer is a good size? Could be. I talked about sizing for Faka Puffers earlier. I think bigger is always better. I think 90 is, it's in the realm of, yeah, maybe. Plans for green spotted puffers with brackish water. Oof, I've talked about this a few times. I'm not good when it comes to plants in brackish water. Some people in the comment section said they did really well with Bacopa. That being said, I've never had that great of luck with plants in brackish water. And I haven't even done it that much, to be honest, because I hate mixing salt. Also, my puffer isn't eating as ghost shrimp or any kind of shrimp. Also, snails didn't work due to the salt, and I can't find clams anywhere. Yeah, so that, you know, you're kind of in a bad situation there. I would hope you could find clams on the half shell at a pet store. If you can't, try buying clams at the supermarket and, you know, having them, try that out. But yeah, I mean, it's difficult, you know, just like you might own a dog and you're like, I've tried 15 different versions of canned food and he hates them all. We all know those people that have that dog that he will only eat eggs and bacon I cook for them in the morning. And it's just, you know, one of those things of like, one, the person keeping the dog's kind of enabling them, and two, the dog itself is picky. Let's see. How to get rid of camelinous worms in fish? I recommend Levamisole, and I personally buy it from Greg Sage at Select Aquatics, and I follow his dosing recommendations. Let's see. Ryan says, Corey, my angels all of a sudden started shredding my aquarium lilies. Any ideas why? I haven't changed any of the feeding schedules. Are they getting any veggie matter in their diet? Like maybe try something like some spirulina flake or something like that. Could be that they're just getting ornery from breeding or something. There's probably some more questions need to be asked there. But a lot of times when a fish that's not normally going after plants starts going after plants, my first thing is, let me look at that fish's diet and see if they could be deficient, you know? Just like humans, sometimes we'll crave salty things, we'll crave, Like, when we get a craving, it's our body telling us we're not intaking enough of that a lot of times. Like, oh man, I really want water. Like, you could be thirsty, but then, you know when you're like thirsty, but then you're like, oh no, I need water. And that's your body going, no, you need water. Quit drinking that Mountain Dew or whatever it is. You need water. And that angelfish might be going through that same thing. Its body is telling it, you need these nutrients. Go get it. And sometimes they're forced to out of a plant. Let's see. How to breed red-bellied piranha. I'm not super familiar with that because they're not legal in my state, but they're an egg scatterer, and I know it can be done. Usually they're doing it in a planted tank, that type of thing, and they'll kind of guard a nest a little bit, but I haven't done a lot of research on it because I can't do it. Can I feed my puffer lobsters? If you mean crayfish, yes, I recommend disabling the claws. Just as a thing, I've tried feeding my puffers things like crab, like Dungeness crab and stuff like that. They hated it. They did not like it. They just always spit it out. So I've never tried like actual lobster like a human would eat. So I don't know. Let's see. I'm getting worried about my tank. I got it cycled, but I did a water change yesterday and the water got cloudy after the water change. Do I need to change it again? Chances are you probably killed bacteria and it bloomed. So you would want to do the opposite and not change water. See, a lot of people think water changes are a good thing. They are only good when they make the water better than it was. So, like when we change water, a lot of things happen. The water parameters change. Water temperature could change a little bit. We could bring things like fluoride back into the water, heavy metals, those types of things. And then there's other things like, when we dropped the water level down 50%, all the bacteria that was on the glass died off. If we also then changed our cartridge filter, we just took a bunch of bacteria out of that. If we, you know, there's lots of things we can do that disrupts that aquarium. So what has happened for you, Mark, most likely, this is most likely, is that we've disrupted that aquarium, we've lost some bacteria, or the aquarium has sensed that it needed more bacteria. Like, let's say you added some fish 2 days ago or something, and it basically blooms and goes, hey, we need more bacteria. Here's this milky water. Eventually, that's going to settle down on decorations, gravel, filter, everything that's underwater, and it'll go away. If we change water, what happens is it basically just goes, oh, we need more bacteria again. Bloom again. And so we're just prolonging it. So I bet the best course of action without knowing more about your situation is to do nothing at this point, which is easy. It's easiest to go, oh, I just won't do anything. So that's a good place to be. Obviously, test your water. Make sure you're on point there. And don't listen to me because I'm crazy. Have I ever cracked a heater while cleaning? I don't think so. I've definitely burned one up, like drained the water down too far and had it crack that way. But not like, I've never like bashed one and cracked it. But I've definitely let them run hot and crack them. Yeah, it sucks. Let's see. All right, this is a question from Charlie's Fish Tanks. I've asked Bob and Lucas this question. Now I'd like to know your opinion. Should I get more domestic discus or Simon Forkel F1 Altum Angelfish? Leaning towards discus, but Altums are rare. My opinion on this is whatever you like. So, like, I don't lean one way towards any of them because I don't want Altums and I don't want discus. But whatever you think you're going to enjoy more is what I would do. That would be my answer because what you enjoy trumps everything else. Even if your goal was to breed both those, if you really want Altum Angels and you don't care about discus, but you think discus is going to make you a lot of money, you will make more money and you will be happier with those Altum Angels because you'll want to do the maintenance. You'll want to go out there and try and sell them. You'll talk about them. You'll love them. Like, why do people, like, I sell a million guppies a day because I actually love guppies. If I hated guppies, I wouldn't talk about them very much in the store and I wouldn't sell nearly as many. It's also, you know, a lot of stores like, why do you sell so many puffer fish? I love puffers. Same thing. Oh, I don't sell any African cichlids. Why? Because I'm burnt out on them. I just don't love them like I love guppies. I mean, I like them, but I don't love them. I don't sit up at night going, ooh, I wonder what rare cichlids are on Aquabid. But I do got guppies, and I do like researching puffers, and I do like goldfish. So the answer to that question is whatever you lay awake at night and go, ooh, I really want, you know, F1 Ultim Angels, or do you want the Dantum Angels, or do you want those Discus? Whatever that is, whatever you're just going, oh man, if I could get those tomorrow, I'd be so happy. That's what you should keep. And it'll your hobby will be better for it every time when you make that kind of decision. Let's see. Isabel asks, what puffers are freshwater? I have rattled that list off a couple of times, and the last couple of times my brain has stopped working in the middle of that list. So if you rewatch the replay, that will tune you in for that. Let's see. My silver dollar has what seems to be some sort of cap over its nostril. It could have been an injury it healed over, but it looks like a clear cap or a bubble over its nostril. I've seen it in angelfish, I've seen it in clown loaches where they get like a mucus coming out of it. I'm not sure what causes it, but usually just good care and some time heals it up. But I'm not exactly sure what you've got going on there. Let's see. Hikari Ikex isn't available locally? Yeah, unfortunately, not all meds are. I'm sure there's other meds that work well. I just don't know them. There's no reason for me to track down more meds when I know it works. It's the same reason when you talk to people that are in the UK, they have great meds too. We can't get them. Like, they've got some great ones for skinny disease in clown loaches and stuff like that. They're not even over here in the US. I would love to get a hold of them, but can't get them. You know, you work with what you got a hold of. That's the thing. So, let's see. Have a nerite snail, will he outgrow a shell? So the way that works, Thomas, is nerite snails actually grow their shell as they grow. So as long as you give them enough calcium, they'll be able to build a shell, and they don't have to go find another shell like a hermit crab or anything like that would. Flynn asks, did I get a chance to research buryatric acid in fish? I have not yet. I've been spending time doing the walls. I also did the carpeting. I don't know if I can show that. Yeah, you can see carpeting down there. You can see here's my drill. Like, I've been straight up like legit working, not like, oh yeah, I'm just typing away on the internet, like physical labor, which my body is not made for physical labor. Let's see. Corey, can you keep ram's horn snails with goldfish? And can you name as many snail-eating fish as you can? That seems like that's a two-hour-long stream. Like, that's going to be a lot. I feel like ram's horn snails are just going to be a choking hazard for goldfish. So I don't recommend it. As far as snail-eating fish, some common ones are going to be lots of loaches, puffers. Lesser-known ones are going to be like a rhodopsy cichlid. There's different African cichlids and stuff that are known snail-eaters. I don't know. I could probably come up with more. I don't want to list like all the loaches and puffers and that type of thing. It's got to be some other stuff that I know are predatory towards snails. How about assassin snail? Turtles. Yep, that would do it. But yeah, that's half the reason I'm raising so many mystery snails and stuff. Feed my puffers and my turtles. It's really good source of calcium for your turtles when you're gut-loading snails and then their shell in general. So, hey, Corey, pea puffers in a high-tech planet tank, CO2, dosing, and aqua soil, 8.6 gallon, and currently has two dwarf honey gouramis and water changes 1 to 2 times a week of 15 to 20%. I feel like there's probably more to that, but got cut off. So if I see the rest of that, I'll answer the question, because that sounds like you've set up the scenario. I just don't know what the question is yet. Maggie says, I dosed my Corydoras school with erythromycin and general cure, and within 24 hours, the tank was full of white squiggles, and the filter was coated in it. Any idea what that was? My guess, this is like just guessing. Without pictures and more info, it makes it hard. And it's really easy to look dumb on a live stream when you don't have all the info. But my guess would possibly be maybe you had glass worms or some other worm living in the substrate or something like that, and it forced it out, and they're being super active because there's an agent in the water being the general cure that might be killing them. But that's all conjecture and guessing at this point. That's my guess from one sentence statement. Here's what I got for you. Let's see here. Is there a ratio of freeze-dried bloodworms to frozen food to flake food you should feed in a 55-gallon community aquarium with gouramis, tetras, and corys? I don't think there's necessarily a ratio. I like somewhere, and you know, if you watched every video I've ever talked about this, you're gonna say you've said something different every time. But I feel like maybe 5 times a week, roughly, should be frozen or freeze-dried. Basically whole ingredient foods. And then 2x a week should be, let's say, pellets or flake or something that's a multi-ingredient food that has lots of vitamins in it. And, you know, so that could be flake food, it could be a pellet, it could be any of those. But I feel like that gives a well-rounded diet for me that I've witnessed. Let's see. Would your Liberty Mollies be okay in an outdoor tote during the summer, or do you think you would keep them inside as best? As long as the temperatures are up, I would put them outside. Yeah, you know, probably from late June, because I know you're kind of on my climate. Late June to maybe early September. You know, so you're only getting like 2 to 3 months, but you'll color them up a lot, and it's pretty fun. You know, if I was you, Flynn, what my goal would be. Try to get some, get them breeding in your home, and then put some outside and play with them there too. Did the turtle eggs hatch? I haven't looked today, but they have not. When I did candle them, there wasn't any masses in there, so that makes me think they're not fertile. But I've got nothing to lose, so I just let them sit in the incubator. If they laid more eggs, I'd probably clear those ones out and I'd put new ones in there. But at the moment, the turtle front. All right, I think this is the follow-up. With the 8.6 gallon, would pea puffers be okay in a CO2-enriched environment as well as the gouramis? Do pea puffers tend to tear up plants? So pea puffers tend to be totally plant-safe. I think you might find some interaction between the pea puffers and the gouramis in that small environment. And the other thing is, I don't know how low your pH is getting with the CO2 being injected in there, but I wouldn't want it to get too low. And then with all animals, so like obviously the gouramis are anabantoids, they can breathe from the surface if they needed to, but pea puffers aren't that way. So I want to make sure that even though you have lots of CO2, I personally still run some airstone, even if it's turned way, 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 way down, to make sure I keep optimum amount of oxygen in there as well. Let's see. Does a 55-gallon or a 40 beer have the same tank footprint, in your opinion? Nope, they're different. So what's typically called a standard 55 would be 4 feet long, 12.5 inches front to back, and a 40 breeder would be 3 feet long, 18 inches front to back. Now, they do have what's called also a 50 breeder, which is that same 36 by 18, but a little bit taller. And they also have what's called a 40 long, which is 48 by 12.5, but not as tall as a 40 breeder. So that's why it gets a little confusing. Any update on the mentor program? Nothing officially. I think Michael Skernick's been working with a few people through Facebook and stuff like that, but nothing in an official capacity. We've had some more people working on the blog, and that's helpful. If you guys want to write for the blog, it's super awesome. The more information we can kind of get out there, I think the better. But nothing on the official, like, you know, coding side of like, here's how I am going to put people with a mentor yet. So, yeah. Let's see. Figure eight puffers and neon tetras. It's kind of been explained in the chat, but yeah. Figure eights are brackish. Neons are fresh. Probably not the best combo. Let's see. DeGul asks, hey, Corey, my Easy Greens got some mold on top. Is it still okay to use? So yes, it's still okay to use. You've got a water mold growing, And what that is usually some light has gotten to it, and then we've got fertilizer in there. And what happens is, I don't have any bottles in here, but as we squirt fertilizer out, right? When you squirt the fertilizer out, it has to take air in. If any mold spores and stuff like that are coming in with your air, it basically can start a culture in there. And if we keep it warm and we provide nutrients and we give it some light, we can get that going. So it isn't harmful. That being said, if you send me an email or something like that, if you care, we can open up a claim with the manufacturer, and typically they'll credit me a bottle and we can send you one out. But in my experience, no problem at all, and doesn't have any impact on the aquarium. And that's why a lot of fertilizer manufacturers actually keep them in white bottles, so you don't see the growths and stuff that are happening. But every time you basically open up infinite nutrients to oxygen and you keep capping it and doing stuff like that, you can grow some stuff. So let's see. One of my mollies does a backflip, so she's nose up. Okay. Why is she doing this? Probably most likely thing is maybe a swim bladder issue, or maybe some organs are shutting down. Like, for instance, if it was a brackish raised one that's in full fresh, or you don't have enough calcium in the water or something. But the answer kind of comes back to not good. I don't know, there's going to be a lot you can do about it. You could maybe look at your water, make sure it doesn't happen again to more of them. But that actual fish there, not a lot, probably. Ryan's fish says, I put 2-month-old guppy fry with my adult guppies. There were a size where they could not get eaten, and the adults were attacking the babies. Could it be because they don't have color yet? Typically, it's not because they don't have color. It could be that the male-female ratio became different. Could be that the tank's too small and they're just crowded. Could be that they think they can eat them. Those are the only things I can think of, but I've never witnessed like a color thing. But this is also why I always raise my fish, my guppies, as a colony, so that I don't run into issues like that. Let's see here. I'm a beginner reefer, and I was wondering if I should get a Fluval Evo. They're a decent little tank. I think they're priced right. You know, I wouldn't necessarily recommend like a Bio Orb or a Bio Cube over one of those, or a JBJ Nano type of tank. I think the Fluval Evos are okay, and I think the protein skimmers are okay. I think finding a tank that you think you're going to like that is low price is a good way to get in, because once you've done your reef tank for a while, you're going to know exactly what you value. So one reef keeper might totally value a sump, and the next one doesn't value it at all. Someone might love T5 lighting, and the next person loves LED. Some people might value in-top fans because they live in a hotter climate, versus, let's say you live in Arizona, and you always have AC, and that's a non-issue. So I think get in cheap with something decent, figure out what is important to the way you're going to keep your reef, and then it's almost always a gateway of like, oh, I have tank number one? Great, now I know what I really want to do, and here's tank number two. Let's see. I've heard of a lot of people keeping and raising neon tetras and brackish tanks. Is that really possible? Yes, because the definition of brackish is so wide that, you know, the tiniest amount of salt, if I drop a grain of salt into water, you could technically argue that is now brackish. So on the very light side of brackish, yes. But on heavier sides, no. That being said, do I think it's a wise thing to stand there and say, like, neon tetras do great in brackish water? No, I don't think so. You know, it might be like saying, I heard that humans can live in 33-degree weather just fine. Like, well, yeah, but they're way more susceptible to disease and, you know, exposure and just stuff like that in general. You might make it through the night tomorrow night sleeping outside. That doesn't mean that was a very good scenario to put yourself in. Let's see. Would a Fluval 2.0 be enough to grow dwarf baby tears in a 65 tall? If you were injecting CO2 and you were very, very good at aquatic plants, I believe it could be done. And then, like, I always follow it up with, But if you were what I just described, you wouldn't have asked me if that light would do it. So typically I would say you're probably going to need more light than that to pull it off, or to not to pull it off, to make it easier. The more light you have, the easier it gets. So if you had two of those, or let's say one of those and a Phoenix Stingray or something like that, it's gonna, you're going to find it be much easier than if you just have the 2.0. Let's see. Where can I sell my African cichlids? I don't know. What type are they? You know, that kind of goes into the breeding fish for profit series. You know, are you just trying to unload ones you don't like? Are they ones you bred? That type of thing. I would say local fish stores, maybe local groups. You know, but it's, to me, if you're not breeding the fish, it's kind of like asking, like, I'm moving. Where can I sell my dogs? Like, well, you don't really sell dogs. Like, they're kind of, you know, no one really wants used, you know, used pets. So it's kind of a weird question. But once we dial it in further, we can give a little more insight probably. Savage Nasty says, where can I find a 150-gallon tank? I'm looking everywhere and I can't find anyone. I want a new one. No one's probably going to carry them in stock. Like, I can order them. The problem is, 150-gallon, the glass is so thick, they're very expensive. Like, a 120-gallon tank is going to be, like, half the price of a 150-gallon tank. Well, not 120. A 125 is going to be, like, half the price, almost, of a 150. And so, 150s are just sold so much less. But if you're local to me, which you're probably not, because you would have called my store and I would already had one for you, but most places that can order tanks can track one down. They're just not going to have one sitting in stock, probably. Let's see. My blue Acara just laid eggs. Anything special I should do? If you've got other fish in the tank, maybe making a divider so they don't have to guard them. Start getting what food you think you're going to feed, whether it's crushed up flake, whether it's first bites, whether it's hatching out live brine. Start thinking about what you're going to do there. But in general, they tend to be decent parents, and you could either raise them in the tank if you wanted, which is a more fun experience, I think, or you could artificially raise them. Once they hatch out, you could like siphon them into a bucket, then pour that into another aquarium or something like that, or you could remove the parents. There's a lot of options there, but I think planning on how you're going to feed them is probably the most beneficial thing you could be planning for right now. Can Sassy join us? Nope, my wife's not home, so I'd have to, it'd be like a 5-minute break of me going into the house. The dogs, they're in our bedroom right now, I know it. They'd be like, what are you doing? So, no dogs tonight, probably. Hey, Corey, when do you consider you have way too many snails in a community tank? So, my definition, personally, is when it prevents food from getting to the fish I want to keep. So, if I had, like, 5 Corydoras, and I drop in, I'm just going to pick like a thing of Rapache food, and it's covered in snails, and no Corydoras can eat it. That's a problem, I think. But if I have guppies, and they're not eating off the bottom, really, do I think that's a problem? Not really. I think they're usually doing me more good than harm. How wide are most 125-gallon tanks? A standard 125 is 6 feet long by 18 inches front to back. Is there any freshwater puffer that can go in a 55-gallon with goldfish and koi? Not really. Not really a good mix there. Where was that question? Oh, right here. I've gotten really interested in Corydoras lately. Do you know anything about Corey's World website? Is it worth a subscription? So let me start by saying I haven't subscribed to it. That being said, I own every book Ian Fuller's ever made, and that's his website. And I love what Ian Fuller does. And in general, he gives out insane amounts of information. I think whether that website's going to be worth it to you or not is whether you're going to spawn Corydoras that people don't normally spawn, because that's where all the Corydora people hang out and trade information and advanced tactics. So whether it's going to be worth it to you is based on what I just said there. If that sounds like, oh man, that sounds amazing and I want to be a part of that, it's worth it. If you're just like, I'm just thinking about keeping some Corydoras, you might come away going, there's a lot of technical information, but was it worth it? You know, so I haven't done it yet because I haven't really hit the like, oh man, let me set up 20 tanks and really buckle down and breed Corydoras. But you would probably be good getting like the breeding book from Ian Fuller. on him, how he bred all his Corydoras. That thing is like a textbook on how to breed Corydoras. Well, well, well worth the money, in my opinion. Should be 10 times the price, and it's still worth it. Can a Mabu puffer eat too much at one time feeding? Technically, yes. Some, you know, think about it like dogs again. Some dogs will overeat, and some you have to, like, say, okay, you can only eat this much, and then some will just eat the right amount. So, you know, I wouldn't be pushing them to the max, but, I would say I usually want to see a belly, but not so much that, you know, it looks like they eat Thanksgiving dinner every day. I'll do it sometimes for, like, the video, because it's a little more fun, but I don't do that every day. Corey, I'm local. I've been looking for a 125-gallon tank. Can you give me a price range? I just quoted someone. Let me look in my email or in my my Facebook, because I just quoted someone yesterday morning. I could give you the price quote. I want to say off the top of my head, $399, I think, because they're not on sale. Sometimes they go on sale, but right now, if you guys don't know this, almost nowhere is going to have big tanks on sale because we're almost to tax return time, and that's when all the big tanks get sold, so wholesalers don't like to put them on sale. Whereas if you go like in the middle of summer, no one's really buying big tanks. So that's the time to get the best deal. But let me see if I can scroll down here and find... It's quite a bit down now because I get so many messages a day. But let me see. Here we go. Looks like the standard pricing. So yeah, a 125, if I just order it for my wholesaler, it would be here on Wednesday, runs $500. A 150 runs $800. Now you might be thinking, well, you can go to PetSmart and you can get the combo for $500. Yep. That's why I don't carry them in stock. That's why a lot of stores don't carry tanks, is because they're sold so cheap. There's no money to be made on them. And so that's the problem. So it might be cheaper to buy one from a PetSmart. Look into that. But I know that I got to sell them for $500 if you're ordering one up from me. That's what I know. All right, so it's 7 o'clock. I'm wrapping this shindig up. I got stuff I got to do. Scrolling through real quick. I do want to shout out, if you guys missed it, Inglorious Bettas, Jeanne, you know, I've had her on the channel before talking bettas and stuff. She did a really cool live stream earlier with, a quite advanced betta breeder. I think he was from Germany. So check that out on her channel. Always, you know, check out Flynn's Fish Forum. He's got a channel going. Michael Skernick, I talked about him earlier today. Who else did I see in here? I saw H2O Plants earlier. You can check out his channel. Bob at Steenfot Aquatics. Who else? Check out the My Aquarium Box people. Peck Tech as well. He did an unboxing. You know, I'm in that My Aquarium Box this month. Who else do I want to give a shout out to at the end here? If I'm missing you, it's nothing personal. Short and Anxious has a channel. Check out LR Bretz. I know he's got a channel. Obviously, I've shown off his fish room, and go to him for shrimp. Has anyone heard from Kyle's Wild World? I think I got a Facebook message from him yesterday. I answered some questions, but I don't know about his YouTube channel. I think that's all I've got. My brain is shot. I'm probably forgetting about people, but, you know, what can I do? Yeah. So anyway, Shashimi's got a channel also. I don't think I've watched it much yet, but I like his graphic because it looks like a goldfish, but it also, to me, looks like a taco that's drinking water. So I think that's cool. But anyway, what do I got coming out this week? I don't know yet. I think it's all still hasn't been edited yet. So I know I did this build. It'll come out eventually. I know I need to do an aquascape on my wife's tank because it's way too overgrown, that type of thing. So yeah, as always, if you have more questions, leave them down below. I'll try and answer them as soon as I can. I think you guys know I'm pretty good about that. Support each other. Support the taco industry, a very important thing that's dying around the country. More tacos need to be consumed. But in general, give me some ideas in the comments down below what you want to see next week. I think next week is just me again. And I think on the 29th, we have penciled in for Michael Skernick. We're going to be talking about, what was it? I don't even know. I don't know if we pinned down the topic yet. And then I've got another one of our viewers, I think, for the fourth. And we're going to talk about fish keeping on a budget. And then I don't know what else I've got going on, but you know how it is. I can only plan so far out, and that's already planned out halfway into next month. So what do I also want to talk about? Buy my stuff. That helps. It does help when you buy my stuff. It keeps Kaylee with a job. We added some stuff to the website through Amazon, so you could buy like your FX filter, buy it on Amazon. That gives us like $5. That's good. I listed all those posters that you've seen around. You can buy those on there. What else do we have? We have the blog. We have the podcast going on the website. We also have, what else did I add? I just added something. Oh, the event calendar. It's not fully built out yet. I'm having the developers change it so it'll show a full year instead of 6 months. But I've put on the events that I know I'm going to, that I've bought plane tickets for. As I buy plane tickets, I'll add the event so that you guys can make arrangements if you want to go there too. But I don't want to tell you like, oh, for sure I'm going here. It turns out I can't go. And then you're like, dude, I bought a plane ticket. How dare you? So I only want to add the events that I actually own the plane ticket for. And that way we can do meetups and stuff like that if you guys want. So hopefully that'll be a cool, fun thing. All right. Thanks to everyone for hanging out. Channel's been growing crazy. The business has been growing crazy. I'm looking at hiring more people again because it's just starting to get out of control, which is a good thing. Good problems to have. So yeah, thanks for hanging out, guys. I'll see you on Wednesday with the next video. Always another video on Friday, usually a live stream on Sunday. But yeah, talk to you later.